That the spirit was present, countering bias, ignorance, or even prejudice in the formation of the canon?
Well, I think when you have a human group, there is bias, ignorance, and prejudice present. I mean, that's just the human reality. Hopefully, when you have this large group of people working together, that the final outcome is the outcome that was desired by the spirit.
That sounds like potluck. Surely there must be something more dramatic and powerful the spirit is doing to modify this group of powerful men.
The spirit works very quietly.
But one passage from the very end of the book of Revelation keeps running through my mind. They're the very last words of the whole Bible, and they read as an open threat to anyone thinking about messing with the book as it's been laid out.
If any man shall add unto these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book. And if any man shall take away from the words of the book, God shall take away his part out of the book of life.
At this point, it seems to me that canon formation is all about a group of rich and powerful people putting a text together and deciding who they want to include in orthodoxy and who they want to exclude. Now, where's the spirit in this? You know what I think? The spirit is at work today. The spirit gives you the ability to see the ignorance, the bias, and the prejudice that was involved and raise questions about the legitimacy and accuracy of what took place. That's the work of the spirit for me, the power to read through what was going on.
But the politics by no means finishes in 4th century Rome. And to get to my Bible in English as it is today, there'd be new authors, editorial feuds, and even bloodshed. Bethlehem, according to Matthew's Gospel, the birthplace of Jesus Christ. But there's another reason why this is a key stop on my trail in search of who wrote the Bible. In the 4th century AD, the list of books in the Bible was more or less fixed, but rewriting what was in them continued. In the 380s, a man called Jerome came here to Bethlehem on orders from the Pope. He took a crash course in Hebrew and soon settled down to work in a cave below this church. His aim? To bring the Bible to a new audience down in the dirt of his home streets back in Rome.
Jerome is really important because he translates the Bible into a popular Western language, Latin. That means it's more accessible and can be read by many more people. He did what the printing press would do later and what the internet does today, revolutionizes access to the Bible.
Jerome's translation was deeply flawed, but it dominated for centuries to come. Pretty much anyone who read the Bible anywhere in the West read Jerome's version of things. But the story of who wrote perhaps the most famous and widely read Bible ever begins 1,000 years later, and for me, much closer to home in Oxford.
By the late 1300s, the books that make up the Bible had been together for 1,000 years, but they weren't translated into English. Now that meant that the only people who could read the Bible were experts in Latin, and there weren't many of those. But things were about to change. A group of scholars decided that they were going to translate the Bible into English. But that was a dangerous thing to do back then. It was an act of subversion, and you were risking your life.
In the 1370s, a scholar called John Wycliffe was causing ripples amongst the church establishment. He was full of militant ideas, not least that the clergy shouldn't be allowed to own their own property. But the real hot potato was Wycliffe's big idea about the Bible.
Wycliffe had a very strong sense that both English society and the English church really needed to be reformed, and above all, to be liberated from the influence of the church based in Rome. And Wycliffe saw that to empower the English people to change things, they need to have access to the Bible in their own language, a language that they could understand.
And this wasn't just about religion. It was about who was controlling who in medieval society.
In the Middle Ages, you cannot separate politics and religion, and Wycliffe was very actively religious and also very active politically. Wycliffe believed the government should be of the people, by the people, for the people, and saw that as grounded in the New Testament. So why shouldn't ordinary people have access to the New Testament and see that idea for themselves?
The problem was that this was downright taboo. The last thing the church wanted to do was give ordinary people the power to come up with their own interpretation of what the Bible said. But Wycliffe urged defiance. Though he never actually translated much himself, he rallied others to pick their way through Jerome's Latin Bible and come up with the first English Bible ever.
Well, this isn't one of Wycliffe's personal Bibles. It's a Wycliffeite Bible. In other words, a Bible produced by Wycliffe and his circle.
Now, how subversive was it to have one of these in your personal possession?
It was illegal to produce a Bible in English. It was illegal to possess a Bible in English.
So having a copy of this by the fireplace in your mansion, the police come in, you're in trouble.
You wouldn't be showing this to any other than your friends.
Pope Martin was so disgusted by what Wycliffe stood for that 44 years after his death, he ordered that his bones be dug up and publicly burned. But another English Bible translator would suffer even worse. His ideas too were formed as a clergyman scholar here in Oxford, and they're a milestone on the road to Protestant England. His name was William Tyndale.
There's no doubt that Tyndale was inspired by Wycliffe's example. But Tyndale was quite convinced that Wycliffe's translations were not good enough. And it wasn't that he based himself on Wycliffe and tried to improve. In many ways, he was starting all over again.
Unlike Wycliffe, Tyndale had access to the Greek text of the New Testament and the Hebrew text of the Old Testament. So rather than work from the flawed Latin of Jerome's Bible, Tyndale could sit down with the originals and put his creative talent to work.
This is a copy of Tyndale's New Testament, the first ever New Testament to be produced directly from the Greek and printed in English. This was mass-produced, much cheaper in comparison with the Wycliffeite version. Tyndale's scholarship in translating the Bible is universally regarded as amazingly good, not simply in terms of the technicalities of translation, but also in terms of the way he actually uses English. Phrases like the salt of the earth. That phrase goes right back to Tyndale.
By the mid-1520s, the ban on an English Bible was so hard-line that Tyndale fled to the continent. But there was no escape. In October 1536, the Catholic authorities captured him. He was strangled and burned at the stake.
But Tyndale's words lingered on. I would argue that whatever English version you're using today, the ghost of Tyndale haunts its pages.
Even before Tyndale's death, it had finally become okay to have an English Bible back in England. The country was now Protestant, but the elite were concerned about continued religious infighting and decided it would be much better if it were their Bible. So in 1604, King James commissioned another